Took on flesh, fullness of God in heaven. the world by darkness slain.
Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since death has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. Lord Christ, the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Yes, hallelujah.
All other ground is sinking sand. Lord Christ, the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
No fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry,
all things. Amen?
Amen.
With him we can do all things.
Amen.
Worship
Amen.
With the choir this morning.
Oh,
all things, 'cause it's you who gives me strength.
Nothing is impossible through you. Blind eyes are open.
You.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. We serve a great God. He does miracles that are great. And there's no one like Him. Paul sums it up pretty good in Colossians 1, 15 through 23. He says, He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by Him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through Him and for Him. And He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. And He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that is everything He might be preeminent. For in Him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through Him to reconcile to Himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of His cross. And you who were once alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, He has now reconciled in His body of flesh by His death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before Him. If indeed you continue in faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from hope of the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and which I, Paul, became a minister. There's a few things I want to bring out in these scriptures this morning. I want you to understand that in Him, all things hold together. See, some of us don't realize what that says, but it says, in Him, all things. In nature, in personal situations, in all things, they hold together in Him. Maybe you wonder, how's my life even being held together this morning? And everything that's gone wrong in my life, how is things being held together? All things are held together in Him. Second thing I want you to see is this, is that He has now reconciled in His body and flesh by His death in order to present you holy and blameless before God. But there's something we've got to do beyond that. We've got to continue in the faith. See, I'm glad I don't have to rely on anything else in this world besides Him. I don't have to rely on the financial systems. I do not have to rely on my president. I do not have to rely on anything in this world but my God. If you agree with that, I want you to put your hands together. Because going back to my first point, He is great because He holds all things together. I want you to stand with me. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer. If that's not enough to praise Him about, I don't know what is. We need to remember today Claude Morgan, Jimmy Lanford. We need to continue to remember the family of Kay Brandenburg. There will be names above me on the screen. I want you to pick out a few of those, and I want us to pray for these needs like they were our own this morning. Father, we come before You today. You are great. You deserve the glory from us. Lord, not for the things that You have given us, not for the works of Your hand, but just because You're God. Yes, we need to praise You. We need to give You thanks for everything that You do in our life. But Lord, we must worship and praise You because You are God. And Lord, You hold all things together. Lord, I thank You that through the blood that was shed on the cross, that I have redemption, that I am made righteous through the righteousness of God. And Lord, if I stay in that faith, if I stay in that line, that You will present me before God blameless. And Lord, we come before You this morning just to worship You, to magnify You, to lift You up. Lord, we thank You for everything that You've done in our lives. But Lord, we thank You for being our God. Lord, we come before You on behalf of the needs of this church. Lord, I pray that You would reach down and that You would minister to each and every need. Lord, I pray that You would uplift this family, Lord, that has had death visit them this week. Lord, I pray that you would comfort them. I pray that you would surround them. Lord, I pray that you would uplift them. Lord, I pray that you would reach down and touch those that have been in the hospital this week. Lord, those that are still in the hospital. Lord, I pray that you would bring strength to their bodies. And Lord, as your eyes look across the sanctuary, you see those that are sitting in this congregation this morning that needs a touch from God. Lord, it may be financial, it may be physical. Lord, it may be a family need. And Lord, I pray that you would just reach down in their situation. I pray that you would bless in their situation. Lord, I pray that you would bring resolution in their situations. And fathers, I come before you this morning. Lord, I fail to do this a lot of times. Lord, but I pray for our men and women, Lord, that are across this world, that are serving this country in armed services. Lord, I pray that you would reach down and strengthen them. Lord, I pray that you would minister to them. Lord, I pray protection upon them today, Lord, as they are fighting for our freedom. Lord, I pray for this country. Lord, let us once again be a country that says, in God we trust. Jehovah God. Lord, let us be able to replace that instead of saying only in God. Let us be able to say, in Jehovah God we trust. Because you are above all. And we worship you today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. It's so good to have you in the house of God this morning. If you're visiting with us this morning for the first time, or maybe you haven't been in a while, can you just lift your hand? We have some information we would like to get to you about our church. Anybody visiting with us this morning? I don't want to miss anybody. Anybody visiting? It's so good to have you with us. We take about a moment or two to fellowship with each other.
Hands. is down low for me. Down like her temperature, cause to me she's 0 degrees. She cold, overfreeze. I got that girl from overseas. Now she's my Miss America. Now can I be her soldier, please? I'm fighting for this girl on the battlefield of love. Don't it look like baby Cupid sending arrows from above? Don't you ever leave the side of me. Indefinitely, not probably, and honestly, I'm down like the economy.
Yeah.
Bring awareness to this disease, and we've played one for several years, and the reason we do that is about 2009, one of the hospitals decided to do that as a way of bringing awareness to breast cancer, and then other hospitals and schools and churches started doing that. So that's just one way, and Pink Sunday is another way, and wearing pink and wearing all the little ribbons, that's just another way. Because this disease needs attention. As I was researching in the past few years, the statistics would say 1 in 8 women will get breast cancer. This year, it was 1 in 7, so that sounds good. We're getting better. Well, actually, I said that backwards. It was 1 in 7. Now it's 1 in 8. It's getting better, not worse. But the reason it's getting better is because of this attention. And why bring attention to it? So you'll get tested. And ladies, we all know what that means, privately and in a facility. Today, we've got many in our congregation that has been affected by this disease. As many of you know, I've told you before, but your pastor, his aunt, his grandmother had it 2 times, and his mother has had breast cancer. And you know, it's not fair, but it happens. And the treatments aren't fair, but they're necessary. And you know, his aunt didn't have to have the chemotherapy that his mom had. She didn't lose her hair, but his mom lost her hair, went through all these treatments that made her very sick, took steroids that made her, you know, blow up and get huge. But she's doing good today, and she's cancer-free. If you are in the house today and you have a family member that had breast cancer, will you please stand? If you had a friend or a coworker that had breast cancer, will you also stand? It's everywhere. It touches the rich, the old. It touches the young and the old. And it touches men, too. Men, you need to be careful. You can be seated. Now we want to honor the survivors. And we've got several in our congregation. Survivors that have had breast cancer, but they have overcome. And Vicky's coming down to help me. Todd's mom had breast cancer, and Vicky's mom had breast cancer about the same time. So they know what it is. And at the end of this, I'm going to get Vicky to pray a prayer for us, to pray for those who may be going through this, who have gone through this, and the family members, because it's devastating to all the family members. But we have survivors in the house. Yay. And I would like for all of our survivors to come stand at the front with us, and we have a gift for you. Don't be ashamed. Come on up. We're proud of you. You've gone through something we haven't gone through. May God bless you all. Today, as you leave, all the ladies in the congregation, we have a small gift for you. It's a pink gift. It's a reminder to do that testing that you need to do, because that's what's going to save the lives. That's what's going to make the numbers go up from 1 in 8 to 1 in 9, 1 in 10. It's what's going to make it go up. Thank you all. We are just so proud of you all for just fighting the fight. Fighting like a girl and fighting the fight. Now Vicki's going to say a prayer for us.
I would like to give the Lord all the praise and the glory, because next month it will be 30 years. Whatsoever, if you let Christ be number one in whatever you do or whatever you say, He'll be faithful to you.
Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for every lady standing at the front of this church. We thank you for your hand of healing upon each and every one of them. We thank you for their testimony, for their strength. Lord, we just thank you for their families that have supported them. Thank you for walking them through that difficult journey. Lord, for those who family members that may be here today and their loved one is not a survivor, Lord, we ask for you to continue to strengthen them and comfort them and be with them. And Lord, help us all to put our hope and our trust in you and in you alone. And Lord, we just trust that you see us through every day, every minute of every day. We give ourselves to you completely. And we thank you that you have the whole world and every one of us in the palm of your hand today. In Jesus' name, amen.
And survivors, I would like for you to go out in the lobby after the service. We'll slip out a little bit early and help us give out those pamphlets and help us to give out those reminder gifts. Thank you very much.
October 30th, have your trunk full of candy so we can give out to the community. Look forward to seeing you at 6:30.
We need your help. We need as many of you that will pack your cars full of candy with a smile on your face to hand out candy to these kids. We're also going to have free hot dogs and fellowship time, but we need your help. We want this parking lot to be full for Trunk or Treat on October 30th. Hope to see you there.
I'm coming. Free hot dogs was the key phrase. Amen. There is a sign-up sheet down the hall on the right on the bulletin board. If you'd like to be part of that as far as decorating your trunk and giving out candy, would you mind signing that? Or if you would not mind, would you sign that? So that we'll have some idea, some clue as to how many are going to be involved. Maybe you've told Donna, and she has a list over there. But I told her a lot of people that are over here don't have to go over there, don't make it over there. And so she's put one up in the hall here. So if you'll do that, we will greatly appreciate that. Thank you for being here today. If you're our guest today, I just want to say a special thank you for being here. You could go anywhere, but you chose to be here, and that means a lot to us, and we don't take it lightly, and we hope that somehow, some way, something that is done or said in this place will make you understand how special the Lord is and how special the people of God are when we come together. And I just want to say hello to those that may be watching us by the way of internet. For the last month or so, we have been streaming live our services, and it's possible this morning that Daryl Crow and Sylvia and Ray are watching us. He was going to ask if that was possible for him to do there in the room he is in. And hey, Daryl. Hey, Sylvia. I feel like the Clampets. You know. If you're younger than you should be, or maybe you don't know who that is. But it's a very wonderful thing. We're having a great number of people that are watching, and it's not just here in Woodruff. It's in other states. And I think we've even had maybe one other country as well. And so anything we can do to outreach from this place to help people hear the gospel, hear it sung, hear it in devotion, hear it preached, see the altar services and experience the power of God, it's a wonderful thing. You used to have to go to ustream.tv to get it, but there is now a link on our website. So you can go directly there and click on it. And if you want to see things that have been recorded, you can still click on that link, and there is a listing of recorded services. So it's just another opportunity that we have to use the technology that the Lord has blessed us with to do what we can to get the gospel message out. So make sure you take advantage of that. If you happen to be on vacation or you're sick, I got a post on my Facebook page last Sunday night. Someone was not able to attend, and they said they watched the service, and that is a blessing. If something happens and you can't, but you can still be part of what's going on in your church. I'm thankful for that. Make sure you get a news and highlights. See all the things that are going on in our church. A lot of things going on, and we want you to be part of that. Our ushers are going to come and wait on us today, and we're going to have an opportunity to give our tithes and our offerings to the Lord. I was given a birthday offering for Ronnie Richards. And it's going to the Pop Pearson Building Fund. That's what they've designated for. Let me just remind you again, you can designate it to anything or in memory or honor of anyone you'd want to. It goes to the Building Fund, so you can do that. And we thank their family and others that give to the Building Fund. Thank you so much for that and for your continued support of the work of God. How many is ready to give today? Okay, how many is ready to give today? Okay, that's better. Father God, we thank you for the privilege and opportunity we have to take the gifts that you have blessed us with. And Lord, through that, take those same gifts and give back to you, realizing that the tenth or the tithe belongs to you already. We simply have to release it and give it to you. And then other than that, the offerings that we give are out of the portion that you have blessed us with. And we do that to say how much we love you and that we do support the work of God. We thank you, Lord, for your blessing on us individually, on our families. We thank you for your blessing upon our church. And we are grateful for your continued blessing on our life. And I pray today, Lord, that as we give our gifts, we'll do it, first of all, as an act of worship. Secondly, we'll do it as an expression of our love. Thirdly, we'll do it as an expression for the love of this local congregation and for your blessings on us. Receive our gifts today. Be pleased. And we'll thank you for what you do. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. Oh, you weren't there. Of the things that had me bound. I spent my days pouring my life without measure into the little treasure box I thought I found. Until the day when Jesus came to me, he filled my the wonder of his touch. So now I'm giving back to him all the praises worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love him so much. And I've come to pour my praise on him like from Mary's alabaster box. Well, don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. Oh,
we understand when we have services where we do things such as the breast cancer awareness, that it calls attention to just one kind of cancer. But we also understand that there are people who have dealt with all kinds. And we also understand that while we do honor the survivors, that there are some in our congregation whose family members did not survive the cancer. They lost the battle, but they won the war. Death has no sting. The grave has no power over those of us that know the Lord Jesus. And we don't forget what you and your family went through. And if you're here today and you had someone in your family, it doesn't have to be breast cancer at all, but it could be any kind of cancer, that they lost the battle, but they've won the war with that cancer. Would you mind standing? We want to honor you and your family today. Amen. Amen. Father God, I pray a blessing over every one of them today. Because, Lord, it's hard to have celebration for those that survive without also having some pain because of their loved one that did not survive. Father God, we're thankful that through all of that, I'm glad the choir sang that song or the praise team sang that song, that your grace is enough. And when we walk through hard times and difficult times, and Lord, when things don't turn out the way we wanted, the way we prayed, it was your grace that got them through. And it's your grace that carries them now. And Lord, it's the assurance. If they knew the Lord Jesus, we know where they are. And that we're only separated for a moment, but one day, should we keep our relationship with Jesus intact, we'll get to be together again for all eternity, never to be separated. And so we pray today you would bless them today, and we honor them today. We ask your Holy Spirit to be real to them, and we'll bless you for it. We ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Can you just give a hand of honor to those family members? Amen. And I just like to kind of give the devil the black eye too. Is that okay? While they're survivors of breast cancer, they're survivors of other kinds of cancer. I saw Alberta a while ago. Where are you at, Alberta? Stand up. Amen. Amen. There's Bo. Amen. Brad. Where's Brad at? Larry. If you're surviving some other cancer, you're beating some other kind of cancer. Buster. Stand up, Buster. Brother Grubbs. Brother Bill. Hallelujah. 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 Bless the Lord. Amen. Amen. There is still power in prayer. Thank God for doctors. Thank God for medicines. Man, I thought back when I was growing up, a lady in our church, her name was Irene Smith, that had, I can't remember what kind of cancer she had. But I know that the medicines that they gave her for treatment made her deathly ill. You know, we've come a long way. It affects us in a lot of ways, but they are able to give us medicines with those things that help us not to be as sick and have a lot of the effects we used to have. And I'm so thankful for doctors and medicines and all of those things, but I'm thankful God still hears. God still has the power to move and do great, mighty things. I want you to turn me this morning to Psalm 38. Psalm 38, and I want to read the first 8 verses. And I'm going to do something this morning I've not done over the last 4 years or so. Normally, we have a portion of the service where we talk about cancer awareness, and we do those presentations, and then we go back to whatever we had planned. But the Lord has spoken to me this week about not letting this opportunity, as we're talking about cancer and other things, to be a teachable moment for us. Psalm 38, and I want to begin at verse 1. O Lord, rebuke me not in thy wrath, neither chasten me in thy hot displeasure. For thine arrows stick fast in me, and thy hand presseth me sore. There is no soundness in my flesh because of thine anger, neither is there any rest in my bones because of my sin. Mine iniquities are gone over my head as a heavy burden that are too heavy for me. My wounds stink and are corrupt because of my foolishness. I'm troubled. I'm bowed down greatly. I go mourning all the day long. For my loins are filled with a loathsome disease, and there is no soundness in my flesh. I am feeble and sore broken. I have roared by reason of the disquietness of my heart. Today, and probably for decades past, cancer is one of those most dreaded words. Sometimes people don't even speak it. They just call it the C word. People will refrain from going to the doctor because they're afraid of what the doctor might tell them. And as you can see from the amount of people that have stood today, cancer basically touches every family. that is around us. Some have survived. Others have not survived. It is dreaded. It is terrible. It is awful. You find all of the adjectives or descriptive words you can find, and that is nothing to describe what cancer does to people. Not only what it does to them physically, what it does to them emotionally, what it does to them even at times spiritually. When you look in the Word of God, there was a disease in the Bible time. It's still alive and around today, but in the Bible times it was as dreaded, it was as terrible as cancer. And it's the word or the disease called leprosy. Leprosy works like this, and forgive me if I read just a little bit, but I wanted to give it to you as I discovered this particular rendering of leprosy. Leprosy begins with an uncountable lethargy and pains in the joints. There appear on the body, especially on the back, symmetrical discolored patches with pink and brown nodules, and the skin becomes thickened. Gradually, the systems move to the face, and the nodules gather around the folds of the cheek, the nose, the lips, and the forehead. The whole appearance of the face is changed till a person loses his human appearance and looks more like a lion. The nodules grow larger and larger. They begin to ulcerate, and from them comes a foul discharge of pus. The eyebrows fall out, and the eyes become staring. The voice becomes hoarse, and the breath wheezes because of the ulceration of the vocal cords. Eventually, the whole body becomes involved. Discolored patches and blisters appear everywhere. The muscles waste away. The tendons contract until the hands look like claws. Next comes the progressive loss of fingers and toes until a whole hand or foot may just drop off. It's a kind of terrible, slow, progressive death of the body. The disease can last from 10 to 30 years and ends in mental decay, coma, and finally, death. If you think about it, some of the things described in leprosy sounds a whole lot like cancer. The way it affects us mentally, the way it takes away our muscle, the way it has a tendency through treatments to make our hair fall out. The Bible used leprosy as a type of sin. It wasn't that when you had leprosy, it meant that you had sin. But the word declared that leprosy was a type of, when you thought about what leprosy did, it's the same thing sin does to your spirit. David, in the text in Psalm 38, described some words, not talking about what he had physically, but he used the leprosy kind of things to describe what was going on in his spirit. He said, "My wounds stink. My loins are filled with loathsome disease. There's no soundness in my flesh. I am feeble." Do you understand? Sin will do the same thing. Sin will make you stink. No, not stink like that. But it'll give to you a sour smell about everything. The thing I've come to understand is sometimes when people have a problem with everything, it's not necessarily that everything's the problem. Sometimes there's something else going on the inside, and it creates a foul odor. It's kind of like the man I've told the story before, who while he was asleep, some of his good friends wiped some Limburger cheese under his nose. And when he woke up, he said, "Whoa, it stinks in here." So he goes out into the bathroom. He said, "It stinks in here." And he goes out into the den, and it stinks out here. And he goes outside the door, and he takes a big whiff, and he said, "The whole world stinks." The problem wasn't the whole world. The problem was right under his nose. Sometimes that's what sin does. It creates an issue where everything seems to stink. There's no soundness in our flesh, and we become spiritually feeble. And you began to look at what sin does. I like what the old radio evangelist Mays Jackson said. He said, "Sin will take you farther than you want to go. It'll keep you longer than you want to stay. And it'll cost you more than you want to pay." How many knows that's true? Sin is like cancer. It's like leprosy. It doesn't want to release you. It doesn't want to let you go. It wants to take charge of your life. It wants to hold on to you and choke you until it kills you. But I got some good news today. There's a verse of scripture nobody has ever heard. It goes like this: for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. What I found out is that the Lord is so merciful. He made a way for sin to be conquered. He made a way for sin to be defeated. He made a way for sin to be removed and vanquished. I'm telling you, I'm glad if I have to have cancer, I have it in this day and age, because there's a greater chance that my cancer can be eradicated, my cancer can be done away with, than there's ever been before. But I've got good news. Since Jesus Christ died on the Calvary, on the cross of Calvary, the power of his blood has never changed. It's always had the power to forgive. It had it back then, and it has it right now. No matter what you've done, no matter how far you've gone, no matter how many sins you think you have, his power, his blood is able to forgive every sin. Remember now, leprosy is a type of sin. And you got to understand, when Jesus walked this earth, he just didn't haphazardly do things. Jesus had a plan for everything he did, including who he healed and what disease they had. Why do you think he healed blind people? Not just so that he could heal blind people and there would be a fame about him and it would cause people to want to hear what he had to say. That's very important. But he also wanted people to know that not only did he came to heal their sicknesses, but he was going to do something greater than that. That when he had the power to forgive their sins, he could open up their blinded spiritual eyes and they could see that he was the Savior, that he was the Messiah, that he was the King of Glory. Why did he open up deaf ears? Yeah, it was to do a physical miracle. Yes, it was so that if he was lifted up, he could draw them into himself. But it was more than that. He wanted them to know that if the Spirit of the Lord could speak to them, if he opened up their spiritual ears, that they could hear the mighty voice of God. Why did he raise the dead? Just so he could prove he could? No. Well, it was a great miracle that lives. Even in the Word of God, we preach about the resurrection of Lazarus and the woman who was the widow of Nain, whose son was dead, and they were in a funeral procession, and Jesus rose him up from the dead. But why did he do it? He did it because he wanted people to know that if you were dead in your trespasses and sins, you might be dead, but he can resurrect you and bring you to spiritual life again. You might have walked in here a dead man, dead woman, but you can walk out alive in Jesus. Oh, how I'm feeling good. I hope y'all ready to stay at about 12:30. Why did Jesus heal lepers? Was it just to say he could? Was it just to draw attention to himself? Was it to give him a platform to preach? Could have been all that. But I think Jesus had far more in mind. I believe not only did he want to heal them of physical leprosy, but he wanted the people to know that if leprosy represents sin, I can do the same thing. What I'm doing to the leper is the same thing I can do to you. Mark chapter 1 gives an interesting story of Jesus encountering one leper. Mark 1, beginning at verse 40. There came a leper to him. Now, wait a minute, lepers aren't supposed to be coming up to people. They're supposed to be at a distance. They're supposed to be saying, unclean, unclean. This leper comes to Jesus, and he beseeches and begs him, kneels down to him, saying, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. Jesus, moved with compassion, put forth his hand and touched him. Wait a minute, you're not supposed to touch lepers. And immediately the leprosy departed from him, and he was cleansed.
And he straightly charged him, and forthwith sent him away. And he said unto him, See thou say nothing to any man, but go thy way, show thyself to the priest, offer for thy cleansing those things which Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. But he went out and began to publish it much, and it blazed abroad the matter insomuch that Jesus could not openly enter the city, but was without in desert places. And they came to him from every quarter. This is what you understand. This is what you see in the story. Number one, Jesus was approachable. Jesus didn't say, whoa, wait a minute, stay on that side of the road. No. Jesus didn't say anything. The man wasn't really thinking, I guess. All he knew is what he had heard about Jesus, that if you can just get to Jesus, Jesus can make a difference. How many knows Jesus can still make a difference? If you can just get to him, he'll make a difference. So he comes right up to Jesus, but Jesus didn't stop him. I want to tell somebody today, Jesus is still approachable. And it says Jesus was moved with compassion. Jesus saw what leprosy was doing to him. Jesus saw that what this man had been created to be, he is not able to be that because of leprosy. Can I tell you, Jesus is still moved with compassion. When he sees people that are messed up with sin, it moves him. We think he's angry. Listen, he doesn't like sin. Listen, God the Father can't tolerate sin. But that's why Jesus came, so he could be the advocate and the intercessor, that he could stand between us and the Father. And when the Father cannot understand all about sin, Jesus says, wait a minute, I've been there. Wait a minute, I've seen what sin does to people. And so when we approach Jesus, Jesus is compassionate because he sees what sin is doing to us. He sees that what we were created to be, we cannot be that because sin has a hold of us, and it moves Jesus. Jesus was not only approachable and compassionate, Jesus was personal. The Bible says he reached out and touched him. See, Jesus was moved with compassion because he understands that what leprosy does, it separates you from your family, it separates you from your friends, and it puts you with a bunch of people whose hands have fallen off, and you can't really have that intimate, close contact like you're used to having. Can I tell you, sin does the same thing. Sin does the exact same thing. It removes you from being touched. Jesus was moved, and understand, this man had been colonized with people who didn't have the ability to touch, and he had been removed that the people that loved him could not touch him. So Jesus said, forget that I might catch a little something. Can I tell you, Jesus wasn't worried about catching leprosy. You want to know why? It's not because the human body of Jesus couldn't have gotten it. It was because Jesus knew who he was. And Jesus knew that while people were afraid of getting what that man had, what he knew was if the man could get what he had, leprosy would be gone. Some of us are afraid to get around sinners because we're afraid we're going to get something they got. And even if we don't do it, we're going to get a bad reputation. We were sitting at the table with sinners. We were eating with atheists. We were doing all kinds of other things. But I want to tell you, what we need to understand is not worry about catching what they got. What we need to be concerned about is, can they catch what we got? Now, I'm not telling you to throw out all caution to the wind. I'm not telling you that you ought not to be careful. But what I'm telling you is, don't be so careful that you isolate yourself and the only people you hang around are Christians. If we do that, we're never going to win the loss. If we do that, we're never going to see those that are bound in sin come free. Oh, I'm having fun. I don't know about y'all. There's one more story I want to tell you. This story has 10 lepers. It's found in Luke chapter 17. It's a little different than what happened with Jesus and the one. Verse 11 of Luke 17 says, it came to pass, when he went to Jerusalem, he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a certain village, There he met 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. That's just the way we're supposed to do it. Sinners out there, Christians in here. This is the way we do church. Them out there, us in here. And as he entered, he met these 10 lepers. They stood afar off and they lifted up their voices. They had to get a little loud because they were some distance away from Jesus. They said, "Jesus, Master, have mercy." Can I tell you that if you have leprosy, you need mercy. And if you have sin in your life, you need mercy. You don't need condemnation. You don't need damnation to hell. You'll get that if you don't repent. What you need from the people who know the Lord is somehow to be shown a little mercy. And when he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourself to the priest." And it come to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. Now, wait a minute. Jesus didn't lay hands on anybody. Jesus didn't get close enough to smell their putrid flesh. But he gave them an instruction. Go, show yourself to the priest. Their cleansing came as a result of being obedient to what Jesus said. As they turned to go to the priest, they were cleansed. 9 of them kept on trucking. I'm not sure if they went to the priest, if they went home. They had the instruction to go. The story tells us one, when he recognized that something was different about him, turned around, went back to Jesus, but he didn't stand afar off. He went right up, got on his knees and face, and fell at the feet of Jesus. Jesus said, "Wait a minute. I thought 10 got cleansed. Where are the other 9? Where are the other ones who've come to give thanks? Where are the other ones who have recognized where the healing came from?" The man wasn't concerned about the other 9. He only wanted to thank the one who had brought cleansing. Then Jesus says, "Your faith has made you whole." If you look at the word in the original language, the word whole means save, heal, or to make whole. In other words, Jesus used this example because he wanted the people to understand that not only does the Lord have the power to cleanse, he has the power to make us whole. He has the power to save us. He doesn't have just the power to wipe your sin away so you have no more condemnation. He has the power to save every part of your body. He has the power from the inside of you, from the top of your head to the soles of your feet, your soul, your spirit. He has the power to absolutely do a total job of salvation. Why are these stories important? Because as we think about cancer, and we've watched it ravage people's body, we've watched it do exactly what leprosy does. Do you know what leprosy does? Leprosy, first of all, will disfigure you. These nodules come up, bumps, knots, and it makes you look like something you were not created to be. Then it will deteriorate you. It absolutely does something to your muscles. It'll do something to the tendons. It'll do something to where parts of your body fall off. Do you know what they do with cancer? That if it's gone too far, they take parts of your body off. It'll disfigure you. It'll deteriorate you. It'll actually distance you. There are times when people are going through certain treatments that they're quarantined. Right? Where you can't go in. If you go in, you got to dress and look just like a doctor. Robe, mask, hat, gloves. Because they don't want you to give them something because their system is so depleted, they could catch anything. And lastly, it'll kill you. That's exactly what sin does. Sin disfigures us. It makes us look like something, appear like something that we were never created to be. It will deteriorate you. It'll cause you to quit ministry. It'll cause you to quit church. It'll cause you to quit on relationships. It'll absolutely steal from you and rob you. It'll create distance. It'll put distance between spouses. It'll put distance between parents and children. It'll put distances between blood kin where we can't even talk to each other. It'll do the same thing in the church where brothers and sisters in Christ can't even talk to each other. We won't even walk down the same aisle in the grocery store. And if we don't get a handle on it, it will kill you. The wages of sin is death. It'll kill you. The reason why churches have gotten involved with doing this, and some people may be uncomfortable talking about breast cancer. But see, we've come to understand that early detection is the key. That if somehow they can find it early, the chances of survival are great. Let me tell you why the church needs to talk about sin. Is because if we can get it detected early, the chances of survival are greater. It'll save you pain. It'll save you trouble. It'll save you from ramifications that'll follow you the rest of your life. What about me? What about what I've done? I just want to remind you one more time. Jesus Christ is approachable. Now, if you're waiting on Him, He's already there. He's as close as the mention of your name. And if He has to, He'll come to you. But it's going to take your call first. You're going to have to be like the lepers. Lord, have mercy on me. Lord, I'm paralyzed. Lord, I'm paralyzed with fear. Lord, I'm afraid of what somebody's going to think. Lord, I'm afraid of what they're going to say. Lord, have mercy on me where I am. Have mercy on me in my car. Have mercy on me in my house. Have mercy on me in my pew. I'm telling you, He'll come to where you are. But you're going to have to call out to Him. He's compassionate. I'm going to tell you, He doesn't like your sin. He does not like your sin. He does not like my sin. He don't like yours either. He don't like your my sin. But He loves you. He loves you. He's compassionate because He sees what sin is doing to you. And He didn't make you that way. You were not created to be what you are. You are not created to have sin so affect you. And what He wants to do is have compassion on you and hear you call out and say, Lord, if you will, you can make me whole. And I promise you, if you say to Him, Lord, if you will, you'll hear a reply, I will, I will, I will. He'll do it. And He will be personal. But I am so defiled by sin. Jesus did not tell the leper in Mark, go dip 7 times in the Jordan. He did not say, I'm just going to speak the word and it'll be done. Jesus reached out and laid His hand on the man. I'm kind of the opinion, had Jesus not touched him, he would have thought he was not good enough for Jesus. But Jesus wanted that man to know, you might have been cut off from all your friends and family. You might have been relinquished to a place where nobody even has fingers to lay their hands on you and to show you what they feel. But I want you to know, you've never gotten out of my sight. I've always known where you were. I've always loved you. I don't like your sin, but I'm pretty partial to you. And if you'll just come here, I will touch you. I'll touch you with my mercy. I'll touch you with my grace. I'll touch you with my forgiveness. Monday night, Brother and Sister Judy Hayes, our prayer leaders led us in a specific time of thought and prayer. It was about doing whatever we had to do to cleanse and purge our own personal life, and praying for our church, and even driving out anything that may be in this building. We used to do that a lot. I know that we'd like to hear, you know, maybe you want a life coach for a pastor who'll just always talk to you about the most positive, uplifting things. But what we don't understand is the reason why we hear those uplifting messages, but every other day of the week we're living in a literal hell on earth. It's because there's sin. And we're trying to hide it, and we're trying to cover it, and we're trying to pretend. And the truth is, we just need to come clean. We just need to be honest. And so, Lord, I thought if I wore long sleeves, shirts, nobody would see the nodules of sin on me. But Lord, you see me. And you know me. Have mercy. And I promise you, he's a compassionate, approachable, touchable, personal Jesus. Father God, we're going to stand and we're going to give people in this room an opportunity. I don't care if they're here as someone who has never committed their life to Jesus, or if they're here as someone who maybe has sat on church pews for years and years. I want them to hear the voice of the Spirit call. I want them today to come clean and recognize that sin is absolutely disfiguring them. It is deteriorating them. It is absolutely harming them. And if they don't catch a hold of it, it will kill them. But Lord, you came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. Today, Lord, I know that you want to show mercy. I know today that you want to remove sin. I know today that you want to set the slate clean. I know today that you want to touch people who come in godly sorrow. And God, you'll do it today. And just like we had some survivors standing who are testifying that they have beat cancer, we'll have some people leave the room today who can testify that they've overcome their sin because Christ took it. Oh, hallelujah. And God, we're going to rejoice in that today. They're going to sing this song that says, "Come just as you are." And I'm begging you, if we've got intercessors in the room, I'm asking you to intercede that there will be absolutely nothing that will prevent people who need to move from moving. What we've got to do is come honest, come clean. What we've got to do is confess it and understand that if we'll do that, he is compassionate, he is approachable, and he is personal. In the name of Jesus, as they start singing, I'm asking you to come. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on.
Hear the Spirit call. Come on. Just as you are.
Come,
come and see.
Come on. Maybe you're afraid to come by yourself. Grab somebody by the hand. Go to somebody you've got confidence in and ask them to walk with you. Maybe you're afraid of who's going to pray with you. Find you somebody you've got confidence in their prayer and go get them and ask them to come and let them pray with you. Come on, in the name of Jesus. Come on. You'll never be free until you're honest. This is your moment in time. This is for you. If you're questioning, where maybe this is for someone else, the Spirit of God speaking to you, this is for you. This is your moment. Brother Jerry, don't you know it's 2 minutes past 12? If we were at the football game and it was tied, every one of you would stay for overtime. Whether you had eaten or not, whether you could get a hold of your loved one or not, you'd stay. Maybe you feel like our text today. Mine iniquities are gone over my head and are a heavy burden that are too heavy for me. My wounds stink and are corrupt because of my foolishness. I'm troubled. I'm bowed down greatly. I mourn all day long. I'm feeble, sore broken. You don't have to be that way. You don't have to stay that way. Hear the words of the song. Come just as you are. Hear the Spirit's call. Come on. This is for you. I'm telling you, Jesus is approachable. I'm telling you, Jesus loves you. Jesus is moved with compassion when he sees what sin is doing. He knows you weren't created for that. It's preventing you from being what he's designed you to be, what he's purposed for your life. Spirit, have your way right now. I'm just waiting on you. I know there may be people ready to go. Lord, right now, I believe that, Lord, it's so easy if someone would just say, Lord, have mercy. Even if they called it from their seat, Lord, you'd be right there. Do I really have to come? No, you don't really have to come, but I'm telling you, if you're wanting to break free from some of the stuff that you're trying to break free from, as long as you keep it hid, as long as you hide in the crowd, but when you step out by faith and you take a move, a step, and you move out in front of people, I want to tell you, he'll walk with you every step of the way, and it'll become a testimony that you're tired of being where you are and doing what you're doing, but you're wanting to make a break, you're wanting to make a change. Remember, the 10 lepers were healed as they turned and went in obedience to what Jesus said. It was as they were walking.
Father God, you make yourself so accessible to us through your Son, Jesus. And you make Jesus so personable to us through the presence of your Holy Spirit. Today, Lord, we've been graced with your awesome presence. From the moment the praise team began to sing, and as the choir sang and reminding us that things don't happen by what we see, it don't happen by what we feel. It happens because you're with us and you provide what we need. And that's what some people in the room need to know today. Lord, it's not based on what we see. It's not even that we see anything looking any different. It's not even that we feel necessarily anything different. It's in what we know and in who we know. And Father God, today, if for some reason there's a bondage that is holding people back from being honest and doing what they need to do today, Lord, I just pray somehow that as much as you have been awesome, that you'll continue to be merciful. God, don't let them ever lose the three most important things they need to know: that Jesus is absolutely approachable, and that Jesus is absolutely lovable, that he is touchable. God, I pray today that maybe the words that we've spoken today will penetrate people in such a way that maybe it's something they have to chew on a while. But Lord, people can still cry out for mercy this afternoon at the lunch table when they're sitting there with family. Lord, when they go to put food in their mouth, but something won't let them begin to eat, there's a lump in their throat. Lord, at that moment, they can simply say, Lord, have mercy. And Jesus will touch them with his forgiveness and wash the sweat slate clean. And I'm asking you today to let it happen as we drive home in the car. Lord, as we're trying to take our nap, but we're restless and cannot, God will cry out for mercy. And you'll be there. God, if it's tonight when we're trying to go to sleep tonight and sleep evades us, or maybe we're woken up in the middle of the night and we can't go back to sleep, but we hear the words of the Spirit calling us to come. We can say, lying on our bed or sitting in our recliner, Lord, have mercy. And you'll be there. And God, I pray that people will not do it and keep it quiet. Let them be like those, that one leper who was instructed by Jesus to not tell anybody, but he couldn't help it. He just went and told everybody that he saw. So much that Jesus couldn't even go out in public. He had to kind of hang out in the desert. Father God, let us be thankful for what you're going to do. And we'll honor you and bless you for all that you do. We ask it in the name that is above every name, the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. God bless you.